from PRX.
Friends beyond the binary, Yodish beings, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, Jedi, you know, whether you're a clone or you like to say something, I don't know how to say it, but, or you just make it like making up words, or you get mixed up when you're trying to start off a podcast. I want you to know you're welcome here. You're what, by saying, welcome to Sleep With Me, the podcast that puts you to sleep. Hey, everybody, this is Scoots here. I put our annual subscriptions on sale, 16% off, still on sale to the end of April, but it backfired. So I'd love to hear feedback. Actually, we still need monthly patrons. So it's not, it was just a sale to say, hey, if you want to sign up as an annual patron, I don't know if that's what backfired. I know it's a tough time right now, believe me. So I totally understand if you could no longer be a patron, and I want to keep the podcast coming out twice a week free for everybody. So if you're in a position to be a patron or an annual patron, monthly or annual, it's a huge, huge support. But somehow putting stuff on sale, I don't know. So if you're here in this spot, whether you become a monthly patron or an annual patron, let me know, because it's huge. And I didn't think, like, by doing a sale, we'd, like, lose patrons. People did sign up, but mostly they were existing patrons. But if you sign up now as an annual patron, you get 16% off between now and the end of April. But if you sign up as a monthly patron, it's a huge help, too. It doesn't make a difference. You get the same ton of bonus content. There's 1,700 episodes. Ad-free episodes, story-only episodes, bonus content in the $5 patron feed, and then over 2,000 something in the $10 and $20 patron feed. You can listen in most podcast apps, Pocket Cast, Overcast, Podcast Addict, Google Podcasts, Apple Podcasts, tons of other ones, and you get to support the show that's putting you to sleep right now. You don't have to listen to me asking for support either, or any sponsor, or anything like that. But best of all, you're part of the family. Sign up for our Discord. That's where our Patreon community is. And let me know, most of all, so I can say thank you for supporting the work me and all the other people who work on the show put into the show, and for keeping this podcast out there. I couldn't do it without you, really. You know, and if you want to sign up now, believe me, think about becoming an annual patron just to save the 16%. But either way, sleepwithmepodcast.com/patron, sleepwithmepodcast.com/patron, and let me know about it if you want to. sleepwithmepodcast.com/patron. Thanks, everybody. All right, everybody, it is time to talk about tonight's sponsor, Helix Sleep. And you've heard me talk about how much I love my Helix Dusk Lux, and I love from hearing from listeners what mattress they get matched up with. So take that quiz, helixsleep.com/sleep, and let me know which mattress you get matched up with. You know, Helix is a premium mattress brand that provides tailored mattresses based on your unique sleep preferences. You know, I took that quiz. I sleep on my side. I sleep on my stomach. I like to be cool when I sleep, and I got matched with the Helix Dusk Lux. Not only that, Helix supports military, first responders, teachers, and students by giving them a special discount on site. Each and every Helix mattress is made in the USA by a team of skilled manufacturers and shipped directly from their facility to your door. You should never have to compromise on comfort. Helix has mattresses with cooling technology that helps regulate your body temperature whatever the season. And I don't know if there's anything worse than having to go to a mattress store and lay down on a mattress. You know, hundreds of people have tried it before you got there. You've got a salesperson watching you, asking you questions. Well, guess what? You can order a Helix mattress online and receive easy, no-contact delivery. And you don't have to be nervous about it, because the Helix quiz takes into account your individual sleep preferences to match you and your partner with the perfect mattress for you. Plus, you get 100 nights risk-free to try it out. Helix has over 1,200 five-star reviews. And by supporting Helix, you're allowing them to support me and my show. So go purchase your Helix and thank me later for your best night's sleep. Not only is it the best mattress I've slept on, but the setup is fast and easy. Like I said, Helix mattresses are delivered in a box straight to your door for free. And Helix is offering 20% off all mattress orders and 2 free pillows for our listeners. Go to helixsleep.com/sleep. This is the best offer yet, and it won't last long. With Helix, better sleep starts now. Go to helixsleep.com/sleep. Thanks, everybody. All right, everybody. It is time for the Sleepy Supporter Zone, the one part of the podcast I need you here. It's where I pop my peas, if you please. I thank the listeners who supported the sponsors, supported the show, so the show could come out free twice a week. And I do want you to know, if you cannot afford to support the show or the sponsors, do not worry. We've done surveys. You don't. If you can't afford to support the show, you don't need to. It'll be here for you because we have a lot of listeners. That means that there is a large number of listeners in a position to either support the show or support the sponsor. So don't worry about it. Like I've heard from some people, and I just want you to know, don't worry about it. We're here for you. That's why I do things like the Sleepy Supporter Zone. So pressure off. You can spread the word about the show if you feel like you need to do something, though. So I want to thank Bree and Katie, who got Sleep Phones. Sleep Phones is not a sponsor, but it's Sleep With Me merch. It's a huge way to support the show. Go to Sleep Phones, sleepwithmepodcast.com/sleepphones. Get your Sleep With Me branded Sleep Phones. You sleep with me for $5 off. Thank you, Bree and Katie. Couldn't do it without listeners like you. The second part of the Sleepy Supporter Zone is you getting the support you need right now. If you're having a tough time, there's links to resources, international resources you could connect with right now. It's also about being a part of community, being a part of positive change, not just saying Black Lives Matter, not just saying stop AAPI hate, not just saying support Ukraine, but taking action and learning more. There's links to resources where you could do that right in our show notes. And one of the things we're doing as a community is raising money and building hygiene kits for the Midnight Mission in Los Angeles for people experiencing homelessness. You could use the links in our show notes to take part. Please do so. We'd love it. That's the end of the Sleepy Supporter Zone. Oh, Mystery Barb, a lot of people help out on the show. Who are they?
Chris Posty Poster Song.
Sounds like a near fall.
Wrote the theme song.
Edits episodes too.
Carl W. The Legend.
Also edits episodes.
Ashley, Kenny, Scotty, Jennifer.
Runner, runner, runner.
I am the Mystery Bard.
I do the lullabies, yeah.
I do commissions at
JonathanMann.net.
I'll write a song for you.
Any reason at all.
You can tell me the story and
I'll make it personal.
You see the kindness shine straight on through when the listeners form their own Facebook group. Keith, Stacy, Sarah, Julie, and Jennifer. These are your moderators. Get support, dear Scooter, on Patreon. Buy the merch and support the sponsors. You can find anything you want at sleepwithmepodcast.com. And we're so proud that we could dance. Rusty Biscuit, Lois, Anna like banana. Leah does the transcripts.
Thanks, Mystery Bard. Don't forget, get your Sleep Phones if you're looking for the most comfortable way to listen to Sleep With Me. sleepwithmepodcast.com/sleepphones and use Sleep With Me at checkout to get $5 off. Thanks, everybody. And what do you say we slow it down and get on with the show? Hey, everybody, this is Scoots. We pull episodes out of the archives every once in a while when I get listener requests. And this is a listener favorite I've said, we're getting close to springtime. So let me dig into the archives, find an episode people have been asking about, and give you a little bit of blast from the past. We'll be back with a new episode. So I hope you enjoy this episode. If you really love archived episodes, we have over 500 episodes in the free feed. $5 patrons get access back to episode 355, and $10 and $20 patrons get access all the way back to episode 2. But here's one for you, and so you can really enjoy it. Take it away, Scoots. Hey, are you up all night tossing, turning, mind racing, trouble getting to sleep, trouble staying asleep? Well, welcome. This is Sleep With Me, the podcast that's here to put you to sleep. We do it a bedtime story. All you need to do is get in bed, turn out the lights, and press play. I'm going to do the rest. And what is the rest, you might say? You might inquire. You might ask. If I had a suggestion box, I guess you wouldn't put it in the suggestion box. Here's the suggestion. Answer this question. What's the rest? Well, okay. I'll take your suggestion. I'll turn it into a question, and I'll do it right now. What's the rest? I'm going to create a safe place. I'm going to set aside. I'm going to carve it out. I'm going to pad it out. A safe place where you can set aside whatever's been keeping you up at night, whether it's thinking, work thoughts, family thoughts, life thoughts, thinking, overthinking, underthinking, anxiety, fear, stirred up emotion, physical pain. Noisy neighbors. Every week I get here from at least one person with a noisy neighbor. But whatever. If it's none of those, or if she's all of those, holy mackerel. Maybe you should put one podcast in it. No, that wouldn't work if you put my podcast, different podcast in each year. But whatever it is, it's keeping you up. I'm going to send my voice across the deep, dark night here. I'm going to use, tonight I don't even, I think I'm a little worn down, so I don't have, I just have straight creaky tones. I don't know if I have lulling, soothing tones. But I'll tell you what my tones can't do, my pace can, so I'll have a lulling, soothing pace. Pointless meanders, pregnant pauses. I guess they call them pregnant pauses because they're pregnant with meaning is the subtext there. My pauses will have no non-subtextual, non-textual, textureless pauses. Well, then, no, I actually prefer everything in the podcast to have a texture to it, so that's not true. Pondering pauses, that's exactly what we do here. What's the P word I'm trying to think of? This is when I wish I had an imaginary friend that was brighter than me. No offense. I haven't spoken to my imaginary friend in like 35 years. That's the kind of person I am. Oh boy, way off the rails here. But what I'm going to try to do, this could be the night I have imaginary, this could be tonight's episode, imaginary friend reunion. I should call my mom to find out what my imaginary friend's name is. Maybe we'll do that live on the show. We've never done that, but now that'd wake people up. But I'll pause it and call her. I'll put it in the bloopers, too. I don't know what time it is, though. I think it's late there. But anyway, sorry about that. If you're new here, what I'm going to do is tell a little bedtime story. It looks like tonight I thought it was going to be about one thing, but it sounds like it might be imaginary friend-based. But who knows? But the main idea is, if you're in bed and you've properly, either you just plopped into bed because you're worn out, or you did all sorts of sleep hygiene stuff, or maybe you were just so busy, and you said, I'm going to bed. And then you lie down, and then sleep is elusive because of any of those things I listed. A lot of times there's a narrative that crops up in your brain. Your brain's trying to process it or make sense of it. And one way we do that is like story, or it might be a dialogue where you're having a dialogue with yourself or different parts of yourself. And sometimes, I know for me, it can feed the inability to sleep and then start to really trigger more and more layers of feelings and even desperation. Saying, well, geez, what am I going to do now? And they say, well, if you can't solve these problems, you'll never get to sleep. But it's not really useful at bedtime. And a lot of it is kind of like this. I don't know. I'm not, let's just get this out there. I'm not a professional when it comes to sleep or mental health or physical health. So I'm just, I'm just a pregnant ponderer. Whoops. I'm just pausing. I guess I kind of am a pregnant ponderer. I mean, my brain is pregnant with ponderings for sure. No doubt about it. Yeah, I'm the ponderer, the pregnant ponderer. And my brain goes around and around and around and around and around. All that stuff, it's like, well, geez, I'm really powerless at bedtime to do anything about all these issues you're berating me about. But see, you get kind of, it's kind of like that circular thing or that self, what do they call it? Self-fulfilling or self, the thing that's impossible that generates its own energy thing. But whatever it is, it's really hard to take a step out of that. And so what I do is I kind of offer an alternative here. And this is different. It's a little bit strange, a little bit odd. It doesn't work for everybody, but instead of getting caught up in your thoughts or your reactions or whatever you want to, however you want to define it for yourself, I say, hey, let's just take a breath here. I'm a little bit of a goofball. I'll be, you've been listening to me ramble. I'm pregnant. Congratulations, you're pregnant with a brain load of ponderings. And I say, great, but I don't really have a way to deal with them other than to do this and say, so see, just it worked out just fine. Did you see how my brain tried to go in and give it to me? Because my brain's, I mean, only the brain or the limbic system would try to say, okay, you got a brain full of ponderings. So another part of my brain said, well, we better shame him about that because that'll get everything straight. That'll get him on the straight and narrow. Oh boy, that's going to get his life right in order. And see, there's really, it's like the manager's, I don't know. So instead of even getting involved or pulled into that, you know, you can just listen to me ramble. And you can even point out to your brain and say, geez, you know, you could even call a meeting yourself just to, you know, quick meeting, be like, hey, brain and body team, emotion team, come on in. We've been listening to this scooter guy ramble on here. Would you believe he's pregnant with ponderings, I believe, pausing ponderings or some such thing. And then, you know, the intelligence section's like, excuse me, that's not possible. And then that person gets to, haven't you been listening? It contradicts all known data, but it's, you know. So you can just call your team in and let them be distracted by me. Be like, you were doing a great job. Look at this scooter guy. And he said we could just listen to him. And he's going to try to entertain all our brain parts. Believe it or not, he has the utmost respect for all of you. He's won Brain Bot Entertainer of the Year in imaginary competitions, like 2 or 3 years running. My first year of podcasting, I forgot to, imaginarily nominate myself. So only just 2 years running. But that's it. I don't have a bow to wrap it all up in, but it's to take your mind off of your stuff and just listen to me. And the rest of it will be story-based. This is a, you know, intro where I attempt to explain the mechanics of the podcast, which are elusive even to me to try to figure out and explain. But just to say, hey, you don't have to listen to me. You can kind of listen to me. You don't have to remember what I'm talking about tomorrow. I mean, maybe like 4 days from now, you'll see a pregnancy test and you'll start laughing and you'll be like, that poor guy's pregnant with ponderings. And I say, yeah, I'm going to give that, I got probably quick, you know, more than quintuplets, but, you know, I got bintuplets. But that's it. That's all I want to do here. Take your mind off of stuff and lose your attention. Kind of bring your attention here, and then you can drift off whenever you like. Now, if you can't fall asleep, don't worry about that. I'll be here the whole time, the next 45, 50 minutes, giving it my all. You know, I'll be following some ponderings and seeing where they go. I'll try to be mildly entertaining, you know, humor-like, near humor. You know, if you fall asleep, you won't be missing out on much. But if you can't sleep, you know, I'm going to try to be your friend in the deep, dark night. You're just rambling on here. Which is the intention of either putting you to sleep or keeping you company. So I'm glad you're here. I really appreciate you stopping by. If it's your first few times here, it doesn't work for everybody. It's outside of the norm. You know, give it a couple tries. I hope it works for you. If it doesn't, let me know. I can try to help you find something else. But I appreciate your time. And I really hope I really yearn to help you fall asleep. All right.
All right, everybody, I got a question for you about tonight's sponsor, Air Doctor. What's as cute as a droid from Star Wars, but way more effective? You know, what's better than an imaginary droid? How about breathing clean air? You know, clean air is one of the fastest and easiest ways we can have a positive impact on our health. With Air Doctor, you can improve the quality of your indoor air with a high-quality air purifier. And then all you got to do is breathe. You don't need a droid. You just need an Air Doctor. And an Air Doctor is cuter. You got to check out Air Doctor. You know, we breathe 20,000 breaths a day. An Air Doctor filters out those dangerous contaminants and allergens so our lungs don't have to. An Air Doctor uses an ultra HEPA filter that's been independently tested to remove 99.99% of tested bacteria and viruses. And you know, allergens can vary in size, but the average pollen size is about 25 microns. Here's the thing, Air Doctor captures particles as small as 0.003 microns in size. That's 100 times smaller than even the HEPA standard. And the one I have is the classic Air
Doctor 3000 purifier. It's powerful enough to circulate the air in a 630 plus square foot room 4 times an hour. So you know you're breathing clean. And with Air Doctor, there's no need to worry about noise. They use their exclusive professional whisper jet fans that are 30% quieter than the fans found in ordinary air purifiers. That means you can run Air Doctor at the highest speeds while still enjoying a peaceful home environment. And it has this auto mode feature, which takes the guesswork out of clean air. I love my Air Doctor. It's really that simple. And I know all night long, I'll be breathing fresh air. In my daughter's room, she'll be breathing fresh air. So it provides even more than peace of mind. An Air Doctor comes with a no questions asked 30-day money back guarantee. So if you don't love it, just send it back for a refund minus shipping. So head to airdoctorpro.com and use the promo code SLEEP. And depending on the model, you'll receive up to 35% off. That's up to 35% off, but only if you go to airdoctorpro.com and use the promo code SLEEP. Thanks, everybody.
Sleep With Me is brought to you by Progressive. Most of you aren't just listening right now. You're driving, cleaning, and even exercising. But what if you could be saving money by switching to Progressive? Drivers who save by switching save nearly $700 on average. And auto customers qualify for an average of 7 discounts. Multitask right now. Quote today at Progressive.com. Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates. National average 12-month savings of $698 by new customers surveyed who saved with Progressive between June 2021 and May 2022. Potential savings will vary. Discounts not available in all states and situations.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, it's time for Trending Twitter Tuesday. So I'm going to look up trends here. On the old, whatever the heck is this called, Tweetbot or something. So I'm going to pause, actually. All right, so I looked up the things, but I forgot I was going to call my mom. It's 10 p.m., March something. My mom, yes, I don't call my mom's phone that often. Oh, why don't you call your mom's phone more often? Because I just call my dad's phone. Okay, that's shaming. I don't see it anywhere in my recents. Boy, that's embarrassing. Okay, this is really burning up time. I got so much I got to do tonight. Oh, other than call your mother, I think. Yep. Yeah, like record the rest of this podcast, watch a Breaking Bad, Ed. Okay, take it easy. Okay, phone's ringing. All right, so my mom didn't answer there. So, because I was thinking while I was doing the intro, I said, oh, yeah, honestly, that was weird. I had this fugue I went into. You know, I did it. That was more of a quick, I don't know if I have a term for that. That was, I didn't fugue, you know, usually I say a fugue stated, but or fugue slipped. But that was more a fugue flash. That's definitely what it was. Somebody pencil that in and definitely see if you can get the DSVM-6 on the phone. And as long as they fired everybody in charge of the DSVM-5, you know, I'm just kidding. Yeah, but really, let's see if we can get fugue flashing in there. And I say, okay, what study? I said, well, I'm a living study, you know. But I fugue flash there. I said, geez, what a, I forgot to take a picture of the trends because I'm, you know. But during the intro, I don't even know what the context was. It came up about my my childhood imaginary friend, and I know I had one. Well, this one's going to get personal quick because I've had a couple of things on my mind this week, actually. So I don't know how we're going to spin a story out of this, but we'll figure it out. But somehow in there, I had an interaction with my childhood imaginary friend who I haven't seen whenever I decided to, you know, to you know, push that part of me, you know, say, well, I don't think I ever grew out of it. Man, it's got to be painful to be. Has there been, hey, has anybody, Pixar, listened to this? Let's get out of this. The pain, it's probably been done, but it's got to be painful being an imaginary friend. Well, I guess that's kind of like Toy Story. Oh, yeah, it's called Toy Story. Toy Story 2, Toy Story 3.
Yeah, you're right. That's exactly, I guess they did do it. That's why I said somebody probably did it. See, I'm even getting criticized here, but yes, yeah, it's incredibly painful to be an imaginary friend. And I guess that was the premise of Toy Story 3. Or, you know, all the toys, you know, it's got to be, depending on which character you identify with, incredibly painful to be berated by Woody, or incredibly painful to be burdened with Buzz Lightyear, you know, just depending on who. And I say, well, that's the great thing about those movies. But anyway, I was saying, man, what if I had a reunion with my childhood imaginary friend? But then I was like, I had to call my mom because I said, I don't even remember. I know I had one. And of course, my mom could get mixed up. And of course, she said, well, it was Albert. And I said, wasn't that Kenneth's? That's my youngest brother. Wasn't it Kenneth's best friend? No, his was Zeke. Yeah, are you sure about that, mom? Because I don't remember talking to anybody named Albert. And they say, geez, remember that episode where I was talking about Kenneth's my buddy, John McDowell? And they say, isn't there like a Buddy Heald? Did they come with last names? Did Cabbage Patch Kids come with last names? I never had one of those either. Oh, well, now you want me to feel bad because I never... No, mom. I was just asking. Hopefully she'll call back during this, but I'll put it in the blooper somewhere. I won't wake anybody up, but... So who was my imaginary friend? And then I'm thinking, geez, what qualities do you look for in an imaginary friend? And I say, or is it just, you know, holy cow, this guy. And again, I'm not trying to hurt any imaginary friends out there or lose that audience. Because, you know, God forbid I spend 80, 90% of my time in my imagination. But actually, I didn't think this is totally pregnant ponder because it offers this contrast. Like, they say, geez, your imaginary friend was really, for a lot of people, was like an imaginary advocate, right? Or maybe it wasn't that strong. But you know, in some sense, once for me at least, maybe my imaginary friend got pushed out by my, you know, internal critic. I mean, huh, this is interesting. I've never thought about this before. I've thought about a lot of elements of this, but, you know, and I know everybody's different, so this is just for me. I'm wondering for myself. I don't know if this is relatable, but when I turned my back on my imaginary friend or lost touch with that imaginary friend that was so important to me, I can't even remember his name. Was that when this other part of me kind of took hold? That was a little more aggressive and, you know, more into punishing me or whatever, you know, whatever tactics you use. Because one thing I think of is that the imaginary friend who likes to do stuff, you know. Imaginary friend be like, hey, let's go do something. And I say, well, it's raining outside. Well, let's just do something, right? Let's have some fun. And I guess, like, as I've gone through maybe the past 10 years or some point, and a lot of my struggles kind of, you know, run parallel to this, I would often wonder, like, when did I start taking life so seriously? And when did I let life take on this weight? That part of me was like, I don't know if the weight of the... that you give to your life is equal to the weight you feel like you're carrying or the level of seriousness that you're giving it. But I said, well, Jesus sure feels that way. So I don't know what to tell you. So I don't know if there's a lesson in here. I mean, for me, that maybe is relatable. And maybe this is the magic of the podcast sometimes for me. This, and maybe it's a little self-indulgent, you know, but... of getting to explore. Maybe I do need an imaginary friend reunion. Yeah, so I guess there's a couple places we could go with this. I think, I wish I had, like, someone I could ask about this, like ask Jack or ask somebody. I wonder if I don't think Jack would be a cool name for an imaginary friend. I mean, one thing would be, figuring out the name of my magic room. But I think it's important, like, the qualities and maybe staying in the moment. Because another thing that came up for me this week, I've been thinking a lot about introversion and my own introversion and just some limitations I have. And being like, Jesus, is there a way I could be more respectful of these? Instead of being like, oh, this is a problem I got to figure out and fix. Or if it wasn't for this, you know, then I would be this, you know. And I don't know what caught my attention about, but I was thinking, geez, when, you know, I haven't investigated this. But, you know, you think about introversion or extroversion or something in between. And I was just getting curious about it. So not on a clinical level or anything like that, but I was like, when did I start? I guess I didn't ask the question this week. Have I, you know, I guess it's a way more accepting way. Maybe that's why people fall into these different camps. But it's like, I mean, I know for me, I'm always looking for certainty. So it's like, oh, you were born an introvert. I'd be like, oh, okay, that gives me some certainty. But that's not where I was thinking this week. I was remembering way, way back. I was like, oh, was I always an introvert or not? Or was there any time or social anxiety, maybe it's different. I mean, I know I'm an introvert because I know my understanding is, okay, if I'm around people, I need some, I don't get recharged when I'm around people. You know, I can be around people and stuff, but my batteries are charged when I have some solace and some downtime. Whereas my understanding that extroverts really gain energy from being around people. So I guess that's a little different than having like social anxiety or just being a bit of a loner, I guess is my thing, or uncomfortableness, all acceptable things. But I was thinking way back when I was probably under the age of 6, because this is when we lived in this small town and I just remember being at this birthday party, and it was on my street that me and my parents lived on at the time. I think I just had my brother, my sister, and my parents at that time. And I can remember going to this birthday party for a neighbor friend of mine, but maybe he was a little bit older than me, but I didn't know his friends, and it was a big birthday party. And I think I had gone to the party alone, or I got dropped off there or something, you know. And I can remember, even though I was very young, that I felt uncomfortable. Like, I didn't know any, you know, that for people that are introverted or have social anxiety, say, geez, I don't know anybody here, which is surprising. And when I was looking back at the memory this week, I said, geez, like, you know, I was already overthinking stuff. And I remember I said, okay, this party is not for me. And then I also had a fantasy. I liked playing with toys, you know, and I also had a fantasy that one day I'd have a bunk bed because I didn't have a bunk bed. And I remember, so I just went up to this kid's room and got in the top bunk of his bunk bed and started playing with some toys or action figures or something. And then I remember a parent or his mother came up and said, no, 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 you got to come down to the party. You can't hide up there. Now, I don't know if this is the same memory or different one. Then I remember winning at Pin the Tail on the Donkey. And I don't think I cheated either, which is rare, you know. I think somehow I won at Pin the Tail on the Donkey by accident. Maybe the mom did that as a present to cheer me up. Or maybe I cheated, but I can remember I don't think I did cheat like that. I was like, wow. But I remember initially I didn't like the idea that the mom was making, but then when it was more structured activities, I felt more comfortable. And then now let's not throw the imaginary friend under the bus, you know, but I said, she's like, I don't know if you're named Buddy Heald or not or whatever, but why weren't you at that party? And imaginary friend would be like, why didn't you invite me, you know, or maybe something else. But, I don't know. I was just thinking about that because I was thinking about introversion and stuff. But like, it makes me think about, well, geez, I'm still trying to buy time to see if my mom calls me back. Or I think of this imaginary friend of mine's name, Patrick. No, I don't think it was Patrick. I think it might be like a longer name like that, though. But, you know, thinking about this, imagine your friends be like, what qualities do you, like, why does a kid choose an imaginary friend? Or some people choose a personified object, maybe, I don't know, like a blankie or bunkie or something like that, or a stuffed animal. Or I don't know, can you have stuffed animal transference? Anyone, you know, mental health professionals or, you know, blanket inanimate transference? But then it gets into these, you know, say, geez, would you want an imaginary friend that's just like you or very different from you? Because I think my imaginary friend, you know, the nameless imaginary friend for now, was a bit different than me because it seemed like he was like, yeah, always like, hey, let's go do something. And not like, well, maybe sometimes, no, I was more of the one, if I was going to do something, it was a bad idea. So if I was going to do something, it'd be like, well, I say, well, what were you thinking? And imagine a friend would be like, well, we could go, you know, dig in the dirt. I say, you know, pretend we're construction workers. And I say, okay, well, I was thinking about taking my clothes off and going in that creek we're not allowed to go into and trying to become a human dam. And I said, that's one of my imaginary friend, which you probably just bolt. And I say, what were you doing in the creek? I was making a human dam. And I figured I'd, you know, take my clothes off so I wouldn't get in trouble. And I never did that. I took my clothes. I made a lot of human dams. I was big on making human dams with water. So there's definitely a difference between being lost in your imagination and being with your imaginary friend. And I guess it echoes like a cooperative play, parallel play. Because that's interesting. Because, you know, like my imaginary friend was, I think, into cooperative play, where parallel play, I think I'm still doing that for the long, you know, 90% of the time. But I remember being big into these dams, just for an example. And always wanted to dam up stuff. And luckily, you know, I lived in Syracuse, so there's a lot of melting snow. So I spent a lot of my damming was on the hill we lived on, you know, using snow to dam, or, you know, rocks and stuff. I guess I'm kind of buying time because I'm just, I don't know how I'm going to have a reunion with someone who I can't quite picture. Who was so far into my past, and it gets so ethereal. Are imaginary friends ethereal or concrete? I mean, obviously they're not. I think my imaginary friend, well, I guess especially because adults couldn't see them. Well, I guess mine were. Yeah, see, he was kind of like a drifting spirit. Maybe, oh, you know what? I think his name was Bill. I think that was his name. I was self, and that was Bill, was my best friend. I'm pretty sure I just hit it. I said, because I was looking at the trends, I said, Bill's self. And I said, that's my best friend, Bill, I believe. My imaginary friend. So I guess this is a strange hybrid thing we're going to do here, but, if everyone can, you know, just lie back and relax a little bit more, if you can. I guess this is an imaginary friend seance, because Bill, I don't know if you can hear me. Please don't freak me out if you can, Bill, because I'm trying to do this podcast. Bill, we were once best friends, and I'm 60 to 70% that was your name. Actually, I can't say we were best friends. But we were friends. You were my imaginary friend. Bill, if you could hear me, you know, give me some traits of yours into my brain. Or, you know, Bill, I shouldn't ask. You know, Bill, I'm here with my podcasting friends. Some are slumbering and some are just resting with us, listening. If you can hear me, Bill, I'm sorry. Lo siento. I'm not sure what did it, what made me let you drift into pure vapor from you know, something much more sublime. I don't know if you would, what state you were in, but I'd like to apologize, you know, not for whatever you put into the friendship bill that I may or may not have returned. I'm not sure what you get out of it. I mean, best, I don't know why I keep using the term best friend. I don't want to put that on you, Bill. But imaginary friendship, I can imagine it's hard, Bill. I don't know. Please don't tell me if you were like 10 times in me with other kids in the neighborhood, or if you were just coming from my inside. If you were, I think it would have been easier to access you, unless you're in that giant repressed zone that takes up so much of me. Oh, Bill, maybe you could be, you know, don't unlock my repressed zone right now, Bill, in the middle of the episode, please. Maybe you could just sneak out of it somehow and keep your fingers there and stuff something in the hole and then go right back and close it up. Please don't unleash the torrent of the repression inside me, Bill. Oh, Bill, I remember laughing with you. A genuine laughter, Bill. I remember talking to my mom about you and having three-way conversations. And maybe you were there when I didn't like that noise at the pancake breakfast. Oh, Bill, my friend, my old friend, you, I can't say, Bill, I'm not saying this hurtfully, but I've become so unfamiliar, I can't even say with honesty that I miss you. For my memory is so faint of you. I think, you know, it's part of your job, Bill. Oh, Bill, I wonder if you've seen any of the Toy Story movies and if they did a good job, if you, you know, you enjoyed them. If you thought the part of Toy Story 3 was the end, and you cried like everyone else. Oh, Bill, hey, that sounds nice, but I don't want to overdo saying, oh, Bill. Hey, oh, Bill, I wonder if you find it deliciously ironic that now I'm a friend of Bill. Or if you knew that back then and you said, oh, boy, this guy's got it coming. And also I apologize if I didn't call you Bill, but I'm pretty sure I did. I'm pretty sure, Mom. Hey, Mom, Bill wants some Fruit Loops. Okay. So, Bill, I don't know. I can feel something there, Bill. And I said, Jesus, at puberty, I think it's pre-puberty, though, that I lost you. And, or is it, did you take on this new role? Bill, when people say shadow self, are you related to the shadow self at all? I wonder that, Bill. I thought it'd be nice if we had a reunion, but this is kind of like a strange date with someone I'm not even sure about, you know, like, say, geez, I don't know if, you know what I mean, Bill? No, I'm not trying to make you uncomfortable, Bill. I'm not going to try to date you. Don't worry, Bill. That imaginary space is right on the edge of the repressed zone, where they bump up against each other. So I'll keep you on the other side of the repressed zone, Bill. I don't know. Can we talk like, I don't know how to talk to you, Bill, buddy. I don't know, what would you think? I guess I'll try to talk like you were a pen pal now. Dear Bill, I'm not really skilled at, I'm more good at blathering than pretending I'm writing a, but now I live in Alameda, California, Bill. And I got this podcast, it's a silly podcast, the puppy will sleep, kind of fun, you're on it now, congratulations, Bill. Yeah, I've been doing the podcast for a few years and I got a bunch of other stuff, you know, but that's mostly, I work on the podcast. I got a couple other things going, Bill. You probably know I'm a little bit of a, you know, nervous guy. Well, I guess I'm not nervous, right, Bill? Thanks. Oh, guys, Bill just intervened on my behalf, I think. Bill, is this, do you like when I'm pen-palling you? No, okay, we're on to something. I've got Bill here. I'm sensing Bill. For some reason, I got that guy from Northern Exposure. Bill, is that you? Do you look like the guy that's in that new My Greek Wedding 2 and from Northern Exposure? And you also, I think, made fancy furniture on Sex in the City. And that's weird, Bill. I think you're naked. Yeah, you can't be. That would make you a little bit older than me. Maybe someone's watching that movie. It's just streaming through my brain right now. So anyway, Bill, I don't know. He seems like a nice guy, even though I can't remember his name either. I couldn't remember your name, though, Bill. And I think I've watched one episode of Northern Exposure. I think he was the DJ. It seemed like that show was just on at the wrong time in my life. I don't know when it was on, but he seemed cool. And then I did watch, I think I saw those Sex in the Cities with you, and I saw the first Greek Wedding movie. But now I'm distraught. Bill, I'm sorry. I got a little, I was still seeing. Okay. Oh, I just had his name from one of the shows pop in my brain and pop back out. Oh, I think that his name was Aiden, Bill. But Bill, I was just wondering if you'd want to join me for a reunion. Maybe we could start somewhere. Maybe I could take you somewhere, Bill, with me. I guess I didn't think you'd put me on the spot, though, Bill. Where should we go? Someplace nice. You could sit here while I podcast. That wouldn't be a very good way to reunite, though. Or I would sing to you, Bill, but, you know, reunited with my imaginary. Were we best friends, Bill? It terrifies me to ask, what qualities did you see in me as a best friend? Were we, you know, potential best, imaginary human, the Andrew Ackerman story, Gingerbread Press 2020. I think that might actually be, Bill, would you be the imaginary, could you write an autobiography for me? And don't put any real stuff in it, Bill, just make it fiction, thanks. But Bill, I guess I got off track because I think I was getting too emotionally, you know, intimacy. I got to brave some intimacy, I know, Bill. So I guess, Bill, I'm sorry. I guess I was trying to use different tactics to like make it less intimate. But I'm sorry, you know, I don't know what happened. I know, you know, it's just some stuff they call progress or development happened. And, you know, I get this real grouchy part of me that grew. And I don't know if that's you, Bill, or that's me. Were you a part of me or were you an external part? I don't know, Bill, and any of that stuff. I don't really understand it. So I spend so much time and money trying to, or a lot of time just thinking about it. But Bill, I don't know if it, I bet you, I'm sorry. I bet you it hurts your feelings, you know. Well, wherever you are, you know, we had some fun times together, and I don't know if I always took you up on the fun times, but you were there for me. I don't know if it's worse that I lost track of you and let you evaporate, for lack of a better term, or that I didn't delight in the time I had for you. I think that's probably the bigger sin, Bill. Not delighting in the time I had with you. So I'm sorry for that. And I guess I'm honestly having as deep as a level of sorrow as I'm comfortable with right now, Bill. You know, geez, I'm sorry I left you behind. And I don't know if you'd want to reunite and do something. What do you think we could go on a Ferris wheel ride? No. Well, that's good. Bill's got an opinion, so that's a plus. Great. Everybody that comes on this podcast got an opinion. Okay, Bill. Well, I'm out of ideas of what we could do. Would you want to go on a drive with me? Maybe. Okay. Bill shrugged his shoulders. Okay, this is definitely the right imaginary friend. Oh, you want to go back there to our childhood home? Part of our childhood home. Were you there when I visited this summer? It was a strange feeling, yeah. The house I lived in until I was like 5 or 6 years old. Yeah, that was weird, Bill, going back there. And the house was a little bit different, and things looked the same but different. And then we went up that street that ran parallel to it, and I said, "Geez, this is a street from my dreams." And it was just a recent dream that had been on that street, where the backyard of the house. Remember, we were looking and we could see the back of the house from my childhood. But yeah, I remember being in that backyard. It was a small, it had a giant industrial tire painted red or blue or at different points. So I can remember that, Bill. And then I can remember that it was surrounded by an old wooden fence, a tall wooden fence with those. But I remember we had some good times at that tire, Bill. And yeah, I remember the rocking horse. I know you were going to bring that up. It's dangerously tropey, you know, because the D.H. Lawrence kind of, cornered the market on rocking horse-related childhood metaphors. But I can remember that was before we were even, maybe you did know about D.H. Lawrence back then, Bill, but I didn't. But I remember rocking on that rocking horse. And I don't think they make those because they had the springs, it had probably 8 springs, 2 on each side, 2 on the front left, 2 on the front right. So it was kind of a bouncing. It wasn't a rocking horse. No, I think it did rock back and forth, but with a spring motion. And I can remember being there, Bill, with you. And I think it was my grandfather, and they were watching horse racing, and I was racing with you, Bill. And the horse, of course. Were you my trainer? And yeah, I can remember the energy of that horse and the movements. And it being soothing and cathartic at the same time. But I don't really remember any other stuff we did, Bill. What time we spent together. And I didn't think you left me, I left you. Because they say, geez, maybe we need to reunite, you and I, Bill. Maybe it could be a relatable way for other people to start this quest. And then, maybe we can make some money off it, write a book, return to the imaginary friend. And then we could do one about parenting, fostering imaginary friendships. That's too clinical. What do you even know, Bill? You okay? Well, we should just do it for free, right? Free and imaginary. But I kind of wonder, Bill, I was saying this before I reached out to you. And I get my fingers crossed because I hope your name's Bill. Holy mackerel. Can you imagine if I crossed paths with somebody else's imaginary friend? Or, I don't know if there's like a place where you all the imaginary friends hang out, but if you have to go back there. And they're like, "You're a human, didn't even know your name." Oh, Bill, I'm sorry. But that would be, that's kind of par for the course, being my imaginary friend, right? Okay, so you get me. That's good. So Bill does get me. But you know what I mean, Bill? Like, because I was saying, what if there was an imaginary advocate? Because at some point, not only did I just give up on you, I kind of gave up on myself. You know that. And maybe that hurt you too. But then I said, well, let me figure out a way to manage all this. And I kind of got this part of me. And this is a kind of broad generalization, this critical part of me, Bill. I guess I'm still curious, you know, are you involved there? Or did I repurpose your role? Maybe I could unpurpose it now. Or if you're two separate parts of me, or if it even matters, you know. Or maybe that's where I could ask for help to intervene here. I'm trying to help this other part of me out. Trying to figure out how to treat human beings and all the wonderful personalities that make me up with some dignity and respect. But I guess it's, you know, maybe it starts with us, Bill. What do you say we go to the New York State Fair? Yeah, let's go for just a few minutes, Bill. And we'll go in through the gate across from Crucible Steel Mill. I think it's now owned by Bethlehem Steel, Bill. But back when, did I ever take you to the New York State Fair with me, Bill? Oh, you've been, okay. So we're going through, it's a weekday, because I know Dad would take an afternoon off of work so we could go on a weekday. To the New York State Fair. We're going in this entrance by the steel mill. And I can't remember where we parked, but we're, you know, I'm a kid. I don't really need to know. We're getting our lost kid tags. Wegmans, New York State Fair. Bright orange. We're going to write our names on it. I'm going to make yours out, Bill A. I'm going to put my name and address on there, Bill. Maybe I'll take you. I'll be me now, and you could be a little Bill. How's that sound? Yeah, let me take your hand here, Bill. And so if you get lost, just find one of these guys and say, hey, I'm lost. My name's Bill. I don't know if they'll be able to see or not, but in this case, they will. So yeah, the New York State Fair, Bill. This is the great New York State Fair. You can hear all the announcements going on and the smells. And to our left is the Center of Progress, the Center of Progress or Progress Center building or something. That's where they sell the crap in there. It's fun to go in, though. But we won't go in there today. We'll just spend a few minutes. You got to use the restroom. There's a restroom there. Oh, no, you don't have a bladder. Great. Does that mean you and I don't have to buy any freaking food? Oh, you want, that smells good, huh? You want some cotton candy, Bill? No problem. So we're going to walk here. This is the main entrance up here on the right. There's a couple radio stations, 95X. That was used to be classic rock. I don't know. There's 94. I think that used to be adult contemporary. I think they called it. Yeah, so then used to be Cole, I think it's Cole Muffler Court, or it used to be Cole Muffler, I think it's Miller Court. Now it's Cole Muffler Court, Bill. And then here is the New York State, celebration of things made in New York State. Yeah, well, no, like goods, you know, like, see, there's cider, and it's like, Artisan goods, yeah, Bill. What's the one thing you want to do when you're here, Bill? Would you like to go on a carousel ride or a Ferris wheel ride with me, Bill? I'll buy you cotton candy. Maybe. Let's just walk through here. There's stands of deep fried and fried foods and so many options. And smells, but I guess I'm getting distracted. Bill, it's good to be walking with you. Do you like it here? Do you like the warm summer air? It's the end of the summer. And, you know, I guess a little, you know, I know, Bill, it's a little strange reconnecting after all these years. And I want to welcome you back. I know you're hesitant to trust me. And I can totally understand that. Don't worry, I'll buy it. Let's see, would you want some pink or some blue? You want it in a stick or in a bag? Of course on a stick. Who? In a bag just feels like, you're right. Oh, she's giving you both. And I won't tell you that. In my opinion, it all tastes the same, but it tastes great, huh, Bill? Oh, wow. So you can eat cotton candy, but you don't need to use the restroom. So let's just skip across the fair, you know, Bill, and let's go straight to the midway. It's dusk now, and the lights are starting to go on, huh? And the noises, we can hear the squeals and the sounds, Bill. And, yeah, let's get in line here. I got us some tickets. You know, they usually don't use tickets, but since this is a within an imagination. Yeah, that's right, Bill. None of this is real. It's all a construction. Constructed. Oh, thanks. I didn't know you had better grammar than me. That's good to know, Bill. Even better. So, yeah, this is a giant Ferris wheel. We're going to get a view of the sun just setting. It's the perfect New York State temperature, summer. Oh, Bill, I can feel it in my skin, in my pores. I can smell deep fried combined with summer, combined with the livestock here in the sunscreen on this safety bar. But Billy, I wonder if you haven't been around already, we're helping me on this podcast, because I've been wondering if you maybe I have to thank you for this podcast, Bill, because I don't know how I've done it. Every once in a while when I stop and I try to say that it's all real, that I've been following through on this podcast, Bill, I get terrified. And I say, Jesus, can't even possibly be real that I've been telling these stories. And it's counterintuitive and it's, you know, different than how my mind thinks about stuff. And even what a lot of me believes, you know, you're doing, you know it all, Bill. You know me deep down. But there has to be some, there has to be something driving this, Bill, that me following through and having fun despite myself. And I wonder if it's you I should be thanking, Bill. Like, is that a part of your ephemeral nature or however, whatever the correct word is? That you've been, you know, dissipated just into my general imagination? Because I always wonder who makes these podcasts, Bill. Because when I'm not making them and I'm thinking about them, and worrying about them, I'm like, well, this isn't the same person that's making these shows. Or when I look back at, you know, when I took a separate path from you, I say, how is all this, what's going on here? This doesn't make any sense. Oh, thanks, Bill. You didn't have to, are you holding me? Yeah, that's nice, Bill. Thank you. So I guess I gotta thank you. Is this like the footsteps in the sand moment? Imagination. There's no footsteps in the imagination. Okay, so then that's, that makes it tough to tie into a nice little phrase, you know. But so we've been together the whole time. I've just needed to reunite with you. But I still have him having trouble. Oh, it's not supposed to be easy, huh? You're right, I guess. Bill, you're so wise. Why was I holding your hand when you were holding mine? Is that, can we put that on a card? Do you think, Bill, we could sell that? Don't worry about it. It's going to be fine. Oh, you are wise, Bill. So wise. You know, just, you're not wise because you have other imaginary people, do you? Please don't tell me that. The only thing worse than that would be knowing my pillow, sure. Yeah, I am trying to deflect from my uncomfortableness. Yeah. It's okay to be. Yeah. Well, so, Bill, geez, it's good here to be in the sun. I guess I needed the New York State Fair. In this funnel cake I've had in my pocket that I'm going to eat now while you eat your cotton candy. The late summer sun setting on the horizon, this huge, huge Ferris wheel, so safely constructed by these wonderful people running it. you know, that were under, you know, underbid the other company. Great. Yeah, don't worry. I won't worry, Bill. I'm not worried at all. My teeth are chattering from joy. And all the smells. It's still, we still needed to reunite, didn't we, Bill? So what do we do about the, we don't need to do anything? Okay, is that kind of the, one of those paradoxical wisdoms? Maybe, you, Bill. Well, I guess I wasn't ready. That's why I had to set you aside. You're too complex for me, even now. But as a kid, I kind of just needed the easy answers. How the hell did you get so much nuance if you haven't been? Oh, right, you've been here the whole time, but we can't use that other metaphor. Or have you been with other humans again? Please don't. You know, because it said Jesus, Andy was, because I remember when Andy took, at least I remember when he took Buzz Lightyear out of the box. So did you like those movies, Bill? You did. Okay, that's great. And again, Bill, I tried to call my mom to confirm what your name was, but so it's been good to be in with you here. Thanks for holding me and thanks for helping me, I guess. And I hope we can reconnect and reforge a friendship. It might be fun. You're laughing. I seem to have forgotten what fun is. You're right about that, Bill. But maybe I could rediscover it with you. And it's okay, then I'm extroverted, thanks. And then I have social anxiety, thanks. You don't think you could help me with, maybe, you know, because they say, remember with that Worcestershire sauce? No, that wasn't a joke. That really happened, Bill. You're not always there. Yeah, no, that wasn't a joke that I said on the podcast. That really happened. Well, you know, that's the kind of stuff that always happens with when I'm trying to say, hey, how you doing? We'll work on it. Do imaginary friends date? I mean, please don't. Oh, man, Bill, don't tell me that's going to happen. Like, where I'll get a crush on somebody and they'll say, I like, kind of like Bill. Well, Bill's my imaginary friend. He doesn't exist. Yeah, but I like Bill. I'm sorry. You're nice, but Bill's just so, because that always happens to me. You know that, Bill. You were there for those. Yeah, great. Thanks. So I think you're probably, you're very sexual, Bill. Please don't say those kind of things to me. Not now. Oh, but you live within me. I can't understand any of this. Maybe you could you take on more of like a Kung Fu master role at some point for me? I don't have the discipline for Kung Fu. I meant, you know, metaphorically, kind of. Did you just sigh, Bill? Well, anyway, it's good to reconnect with you as this Ferris wheel spins. You know, I've been on a spinning Ferris wheel for so long, but now I'm on is it the same wheel in a different car? Or the same car I've been in all along, but now I'm realizing my best friend here, my imaginary friend, you know, that is somewhat real. Totally real. Sorry, Bill. You don't have to glare. I didn't think imaginary friends glared either. Are you playing with me? I think my playful imaginary best friend, Bill, real. In some sense of the word, well, this is being recorded, Bill. I can't be on record because in California, it's called 50. Okay. Bill's trying to not be critical, but he's trying to correct my behavior. Not used to this kind of dueling of equals, near equals. Bill said Bill thinks he's a freaking comedian. It's just what I need, imaginary friend that's a comedian. Bill, we should get on that imaginary friend comedy tour. Hey, take it. And then if I get nervous, I could just have you take the money. Hey, take it, Bill, my imaginary friend. All right, so as we travel, we're moving in a circle. The sun is setting. My best friend's arms around me. And I feel well. Good night.